I think Rekha, the way she has conducted herself over the years, and if you go back to Rekha's story, that's the reason I wrote about her. Initially, before 1990, she used to give extensive interviews to media. She used to talk extensively, amazing interviews, bold interviews. But something happened post 1990. When I was researching about Rekha, I realized, okay, the interviews are missing. She's not talking to the media anymore. And now we know her as the reclusive diva of the Indian film industry. So this was, something was missing in those years, 1989, 90. So that's how the book begins. Okay, so I'll go back slightly because the reason of writing Rekha is slightly a personal one. One fine day, I came back from my school, and in those times, we used to discuss a cinema, in your drawing rooms, unlike these days when you discuss politics, a lot of politics, right wing and left wing. Those days, we used to talk about films, actors, and actresses. So I came back from school, and my mother, while, we were having lunch together, and my mother told me, Rekha has killed her husband.
Hmm.
Okay, so this was 1990. So this kind of remained with me, and we used to read magazines, and all the magazines were doing cover stories on, the Black Widow, how she was responsible for her husband's death. Her husband was Mukesh Agarwal, of course, a Delhi businessman. But so this kind of remained with me, and I always thought, okay, there was something, and she was responsible for the death of Mukesh Agarwal. Years later, when my first book, my Rajesh Khanna biography, was already published, and I was, in the house of a police officer, a very senior police officer, and I saw a picture of Rekha and Mukesh Agarwal in his drawing room. So I immediately told him, okay, she killed him. No?
Oh no!
That was my memory. So he laughed and he told me, no, that's not the real story. And then he narrated the real story because he was close friends with Mukesh Agarwal, and he knew, and he also, handled that case when that happened, that suicide in Delhi. Hmm. So this was a mind-blowing story. And I said, oh my God, each one of us is thinking, the entire campaign in media was against Rekha, that how she was responsible for her husband's death. And it was because of that instance that she stopped talking to media. She stopped giving those interviews. If you go back there, there are like very few interviews. You can count them on fingers. There's one Simi Grewal interview, or there's one CNN IPN interview, one BBC interview. Very few, like once in 3 years, once in 4 or 5 years. But before 1990, it used to be such a regular affair. Like if there are 12 monthly issues of a Stardust or a Filmfare, like out of those 12 issues, 6 had Rekha on the cover or a special interview of Rekha in of every alternate issue. So this, something had changed. So I started researching, and that's how the book begins. The book begins in 1990, and then, it goes back to her beginning, her childhood, which was a very troubled childhood. She was pulled out of school when she was in class 9. Because they had no money, the family had no money. Though her father was a superstar in Tamil cinema, Jemini Ganesan, but he kind of never accepted Rekha's mom and Rekha. Mm-hmm. So it was a very troubled, a very sad childhood. And then she came to Bombay with her mother when she was 14 years of age in 1969. And then there was, a kind of abuse she went through, constant abuse. About her weight, about her complexion, about how she can't speak Hindi and yet she is in Hindi film industry and what not. And then from that 14-year-old to a girl who doesn't know how to speak Hindi, who according to traditional format wasn't good looking or wasn't fair enough, she went on to win a national award for a role which is Umrao Jaan, speaking impeccable Urdu. So that was the story I wanted to write about, not particularly about her association with a particular superstar. Of course, that's a part of her story. But the story for me was the story of an underdog. There was actually a time of 5 to 6 years when she she actually became the hero of her films. Her films worked because Rekha was in them. Unlike many Bollywood, actresses or superstars who actually needed some superstar, some hero, some male actor to run the films. Rekha actually saw that phase in her career. And she remained relevant for decades, at least 4 decades. And that's a very long time for an actress to remain relevant in Hindi film industry, in this society. The film watching people in North India and Hindi speaking. So it's a story of a winner. That's how I looked at it. What happened actually that in those days, Rekha had started giving interviews. This was post Amitabh Bachchan's Kuli accident, and Rekha kind of was, talking about that I want a family and I want to get married. And there are her statements saying that. And then finally, she called up one of friends in Delhi and said, "Agar koi ladka ho to batana." Those kind of things. I want to get settled now, and if there is a nice guy, I would be okay. So now, during the same time, there was this very popular businessman called Mukesh Agrawal, and his rise was also very sudden. In my childhood, I remember those ads of Hotline, appliances, and he kind of became a very rich businessman. He bought a farmhouse in Mehrauli in Delhi, and so and he was in the page 3 circuit of Delhi. So Rekha's friend suggested that, "Why don't you meet Mukesh?" And then finally, they had a conversation over a phone call, and those phone calls got continued. And they also met a few times. Rekha came to Delhi, and he went to Bombay. And then within a month of meeting, Mukesh Agrawal went to Bombay, and then he just proposed Rekha. Out of the blue. And Rekha said, "Okay, only if we get married this evening, I'm okay with it."
Wow.
So it was already evening, and then they got married in a temple near ISKCON temple in Juhu, a Shiv Mandir, at around 9:30-10 in the night, which was also against the tradition, because the pujari also told them that this can't happen. "Why don't you come tomorrow?" But they said, no, we have to get married today. And this was so sudden. And then they went for their honeymoon to London. And that's when Rekha realized Mukesh Agrawal is taking some medicine. And when she asked him, so Mukesh told her about his condition, that he was going through depression for a very long time. And then later on, they realized, the depression is chronic, and he goes into certain these phases again and again. This was just one point, and then it wasn't a happy marriage also, because he wanted Rekha to shift to Delhi to leave the film industry, or if Rekha was out on a shoot, he used to go to Bombay to go those shoots, and so there was problems between them for sure. No one can really tell what the problems were all about, but it wasn't a happy marriage. So finally they realized that they can't live together, and a divorce was on the cards, and they kind of separated officially. When this happened, Rekha was not even in town. She was in New York for a stage show. In those days, stage shows used to happen, and film stars used to travel for stage shows. So Rekha was in New York when she got this news, and the entire media said that Mukesh Agrawal ne Rekha ke dupatte se phansi laga li. So this was that Rekha's dupatta, because there's an interview of Rekha saying, "It wasn't even my dupatta," and everyone blamed me. And even Mukesh Agrawal's family at that time, because the shock was so sudden, they also said that Rekha is responsible for this. But the truth was that Rekha, they were separated for quite some time. And it was a mutual separation. So she came back, and then there was the entire property thing that, okay, she's coming back to claim Mukesh's property. She never took anything, not even a single rupee, except one camera. This one camera she took back. I have my memories attached to this camera. So she just took one camera, but the entire campaign, inside the film industry, filmmakers, her co-stars, everyone said that we are not going to work with Rekha. How can we work with? She has done something which is against Indian values. Yeah. She has, you know, that kind of, that was such a negative campaign.
Yeah.
So it was, he was a depressed guy and it happened. It was very unfortunate and Rekha talked about it extensively. Yeah. She was completely, for almost a year, there was no interview. She was not talking to the media. She was not coming out of her house.
Yeah.
And there was just one or two filmmakers who signed her in that way. Then there was one film called Khoon Bhari Maang, Rakesh Roshan.
My favorite film.
And later on, when Mukesh passed away, the film which released, the solo release was this film called Phool Bane Angare. It was an action film, a normal Bollywood pot boiler where she was playing a police officer. Hmm. There was no real hero. It is common to every generation, I think. Even now, if you look at a Kangana Ranaut, who's like quite bold,
yeah.
she has gone a little too much on a different tangent. But basically, it is similar personality because she speaks her mind, which is not such a wrong thing to do because male stars, male actors have done that for a very long time. So there should not be a problem if a lady or a female actor is speaking her mind. But normally, the kind of press, the kind of media you get is quite negative. While I was doing the Rekha book, I was researching and I was trying to interview filmmakers who have worked with Rekha, co-stars who have worked with Rekha. I wouldn't name them because mostly when my tape recorder was on, they were like, okay, she was a good actress, blah, blah, blah. As soon as I switched off my tape recorder, they went on and on with their sexist comments. What are you actually going to write about Rekha? Are you going to write about her sex life? You know, there was a common thing, at least three filmmakers, a co-star of Rekha who worked with Rekha in her first film, not the lead actor, but some other actor, and two filmmakers who said, Rekha jisko sabne dekha. And that was a common, the process when I try to fix up interviews while I'm writing my books on film stars or filmmakers, I always tell them while I'm calling or mailing them that I want to know about your professional, you know, association with her, how she was while she was shooting, or her acting technique, or how was she as a person when she came on your set, so your interaction with her. But mostly they were delving into her personal life, and they were, and not on record, because it became really difficult. They used to laugh, ke uske bare mein likhne ko kya hai. An old writer actually told me, ke tumhara naam kharab ho jayega if you're going to write about her, because her life is nothing to be written about. So such were the comments which I have written in the introduction to my book. So that was sad, and it continues to be so. Nothing much has changed, because after the entire Me Too thing, so I think they're scared, but very few have actually changed. There are more educated people as compared to the people in the 1970s in the film industry. There are more educated people and more professional people. They have worked, you know, in all kinds of industries, they're management people, the people from finance. They're basically more educated about the entire worldview and issues also.
Mm.
But not much has changed. Not much has changed. Mm. I can see that even now.
Mm.
Just that no one wants to talk about it anymore, because there's a lot of money involved, unlike 1970s. There's, you know, lots of money riding on actors. So there's one Kangana Ranaut, but even her, if you note down the points, the kind of conversations she used to do, there wasn't nothing very, very wrong about it. You can just dismiss it. Okay, she's just being a little off the tangent. But the kind of press she got after that was kind of sexist and kind. Everyone was attacking Kangana, which is because I think she was an actress. a reflection of our society, not just the film industry. That's how it is in every sector, in every department, in every walk of life. It is not just about film industry for the very reason that the glamour aspect is very high. There's a lot of money. You know, that glamour part, and people assume that, okay, since they are into a profession which seems glamorous, you get the license to talk about them like that. And of course, you know, in the 1970s, the film journalism has also changed. 1950s, 60s, 70s, till 80s, it was easy to get them to talk. Like normal people. It was easy to reach the film stars or filmmakers, unlike these days when the film journalism has completely changed. It is very difficult to reach, say, a Deepika Padukone or a Ranbir Kapoor now. There are like five levels of a PR guy, an agency guy, a secretary, or whatnot. So it's very difficult. So earlier the stars were open about their personal problems also. So if the breakup happened between an actor and an actress, a real life breakup, so in the July version of Stardust, you will get the actor's version. In the August version, you will get the actress. So yeah. that was they were open about it. And now they're no more open. And also with this clickbait journalism, you know, 10 photographs of Malaika Arora in a bikini, or you know, that kind of journalism is going on, and we as a society, because such things are getting a lot of hits, it is going on. So the conversation is not happening. Even when the stars, I get to interview these stars as a film journalism, so the conversations you get, like you're just getting 10 minutes, itni der mein pooch lijiye. So they only talk about the film they are out to promote. They're not talking. So after 10 years, say if you want to write about a Kangana Ranaut or a Deepika Padukone or a Ranveer Singh, it would be very difficult. Because in my case, when Rekha said she don't want to participate in this biography, I went back to the archive and there were like hundreds of interviews about every important event of Rekha's life. You know, everything. Right from Amitabh Bachchan to Jaya Bachchan to Mukesh Agarwal to, you know, all her romances to films to Umrao Jal, she's talking about everything. So it was easier to get her voice in the book. Yeah. Unlike a superstar in 2010 or 2020, they're not talking about themselves. They're only talking about the films they're out to promote, and it is so boring, those conversations. So like you said, what made Rekha such an enigma? I think that's the difference.
Yeah.
Why don't you get such enigmas in Bollywood anymore? Because they don't talk about their lives. They're like cardboard pictures. So they're looking picture perfect, and they're talking only about their new releases, nothing else. That's the difference. In fact, in the 1970s, there were many issues each year where they used to, you know, say Zina Taman will become the guest editor of this magazine. They used to do such issues. So the film stars were actually writing essays with the help, I'm sure, with the help of their, you know, journalists or friends. But they were actually out and talking about important issues in their lives.
Yeah.
There is more awareness, definitely. So and people are scared. Males are scared.
Yeah. So it's not really a change. It's just fear.
I don't know. You will have to wait for that. And because I have, like, again, on record, they're like, we were never into this and we don't want. But off the record, they don't really, most of them don't really believe in the freedom movement. And it's like, this is all for publicity they are doing. And it was always a safe place. That's what they say. I don't know, safe, unsafe. In case of Rekha, there was one very marked event which happened, the famous kissing scene with Vistaji. Such incidents, I don't think that they don't happen on camera anymore. So that kind of awareness is there. The legalities are very strong now. So the contracts are very strong. So if such an issue happens now, it gets a lot of negative press for them. Yeah. It never used to happen in those times. There were many, many incidents which I know which never got the kind of media or the press it should have got. So yeah. that much, that awareness part is definitely better now. And it's more professional.
Hmm.
Definitely more professional. There's a lot of corporate money, and I wouldn't say it is easier to get into the film industry, but yeah, they are open to that. The kind of filmmakers, OTT platforms is there's a lot of content they need. So things have actually changed. So you cannot view this the entire Me Too thing in isolation or the way film industry has changed. There are many factors.
Yeah.
So just viewing Me Too or such issues in isolation doesn't paint the complete picture actually.
Yeah.
I don't think she particularly discouraged. Discouraged should not be the word because the circumstances in which Rekha joined the film industry was not particularly conducive. Like I said, she was pulled out of school and it just sounds glamorous. It is not glamorous. In fact, it wasn't glamorous in 1969 because it wasn't a professional industry in those days. So there was a shift system and an 8-hour long shifts, and the film stars used to work in 2 to 3 shifts. So literally working 20 hours a day. So for a 14-year-old girl who wanted to study, who was good in studies, and come out in to reach Bombay, a place which was a new place, they don't speak, they were not speaking her language. Tamil and Telugu was her language, and she came to Hindi film industry, so it wasn't easy. So she had seen, and then the serial abuse she went through, all kinds of emotional abuse, as a young one. So she actually never wanted anyone from her family to joined the film industry. So that was a very personal thing for her. And in fact, I remember going to for a dinner to a place, a friend's place, who was one of her co-stars. And I realized that he's married to Rekha's sister, because there was this lady sitting in front of me on the dinner table. And I said, she looks like Rekha. I said, yeah, okay, she's Rekha's sister.
Wow.
So this actually happened. And there's this actor called Tej Sapru. She's Tej Sapru's wife. So we had a very nice conversation, and we talked about the family, how Rekha has helped her family, and how her family, her mother and her sister were like everything for her. And we don't talk about this aspect. There are chapters about Rekha's family in the book. But I'm also sad that no one wants to talk about that aspect of her life, that what she has done for her family. And it was a very tough life. It wasn't only glamour. And how it was a mother's struggle also. Again, a very sad life, a sad childhood. And the initial 7 to 8 years till 1976, 1977, when she met Amitabh Bachchan and became serious about her work, particularly. That's what she said initially. But I've learned a lot of professionalism going to Amitabh Bachchan.
Hmm.
So that's how the career graph also changed.
Yeah.
Since they haven't spoken with me, so I will... Yeah. Like I was only stating the facts, if anything that was in public domain, through Rekha's interviews, Amitabh Bachchan's interviews, or Jaya Bachchan's interviews. That's how the format goes in the book. So yeah. Rekha definitely began with this film, and that released in 1976, Do Anjane. It was the film till that point, from 1969 to 76. Rekha wasn't really serious about the career, her career as an actress, because she was very upset. She was just doing it like a daily job, and she wasn't serious. She used to miss her shootings, and she was totally unprofessional. She was thrown out of many films because of that. But she says in many interviews that when I signed this film with Amitabh Bachchan, Do Anjaane, and I was totally sapped because if there was a 6 a.m. shoot, Amitabh Bachchan used to be on set before the before even the technicians. He was there at 5:45 a.m. Mm. That was the kind of discipline. And Amitabh Bachchan is known for that. And then, of course, they became close and... I would not use the word affair, but an association that lasted for many years, and also their firms worked.
Yeah.
And when professionally your firms begin clicking, it actually is very smooth for the film producers also to sign. You know, so that happens with everyone. We have seen like Dilip Kumar Madhubala,
Shah Rukh and Kajol.
So it works like that. So there are like many stories which are not true also.
Hmm.
But in their case, of course, there was something because I spoke with Muzaffar Ali, who directed Rekha in Umrao Jaan. Yash Chopra has openly talked about Silsila and their association. He's talked about that in public domain. So there was definitely something which was very close to her heart, and then there were many cover stories of their relationship going stronger, breaking up. It was normal gossip every month. And then Amitabh Bachchan, for a very long time, almost 15 years, was not talking to the press. So it was the same phase also. So. What the film press decided that they will not print his name, but since his career like completely went berserk and he became the superstar, so there was no way they don't write about him. So they were writing about him as Etchy in the capital or the Lambu or the tall superstar. Even Rekha, they were muting Rekha's interviews also. So if Rekha says something about Amitabh Bachchan, so they convert it into him or he. So throughout that decade, Rekha was talking about him.
Hmm.
So he was a figure constant in her life. But I think even my question while I was writing the book was that if this was happening and if Jaya was very upset with this entire story, whatever, even if this was gossip, why did she? Because she has left firms after her marriage with Mr. Bachchan. Why did she came back to do Silsila? So that was my question. You know, it is mind-boggling. What is the need? Like, there is a story and you have given visuals to that story. Now you think about them and you think about Silsila.
Yeah.
You think about those sequences, those dialogues, those songs.
Yeah.
Had there been no silsila, koi tasveerein nahi hoti dimag mein, koi zehen mein. It had been just a story, just a gossip. So silsila gave us the visuals. And proper visuals, it was the same story. Like Yash Chopra, I'm quoting Yash Chopra, that jo unki asli zindagi mein, jo film mein chal raha tha, that was going on in their real lives also.
Yeah.
So they were also talking about it.
Yeah.
So Silsila didn't work. It flopped when it released. And I think the real breakup, if you call that a breakup, happened when the Kuli tragedy happened, the Kuli accident. And there is a Rekha interview in Filmfare, a 1984 interview, where she says that I was totally heartbroken because I just wanted to see her. Because he was lying in the ICU, but I went there and I was, I was not allowed to meet him. And post that, there was like so many, stories saying that that was the point where a kind of breakup happened.
Yeah.
But at the same time, since there's so many people wanted to know about if it is still going on, because then in 89, there was this film called Akhri Rasta, if you have seen the film. So there was an Amitabh Bachchan Sri Devi film. Sridevi in those days used to dub her dialogues. Someone else used to dub her dialogues because her Hindi was not up to the mark. So Aakhri Rasta, Sridevi's voice is actually Rekha's voice. So this actually happened in many films. Finally, coming back to these days, 2015, there was this film called Shamita. You must be knowing about Shamita. There was this film with Akshara Hassan and Manoj. So the story of Shamitab in a line was that, that Dhanush, who's a film actor in the story, in the film, is mute. He can't speak. So they realize there is some chip different, you know. And Amitabh Bachchan becomes his voice. Amitabh Bachchan is a failed actor in the film whose voice is very good. So it is like Dhanush on screen and they're using Amitabh Bachchan's voice. And I'm talking about this happening inside the film. This is the story of Shamita. So now in the film, Dhanush gets an award. I think Filmfare Award, some film award for the best actor inside the film. So who's coming to give him the best actor award? Guess?
Rekha.
So, Rekha ji. Rekha is giving the award to Dhanush and she's saying, kya awaaz hai aapki? Ye awaaz to Bhagwan kisi ko deta hai. Cut to Amitabh Bachchan. Cut to Amitabh Bachchan who's like sitting somewhere else. Okay, so this is their last film together. This is in 2015. Now my point was that they're not having a scene together. I mean, they're not sharing the frame. But yeah, Rekha is saying this and this is cut to Amitabh Bachchan who's smiling.
Yeah.
And Shamita was produced by Amitabh Bachchan's company. So I don't know, what can I say? Because if so much happened in their family, like it was written about in the press, I don't know, there was no need of a silsila, there was no need of, even a film called Suryavansham, which has so many jokes and memes, because it's such a regular on Sony TV. They have nothing to show. They show Suryavansham. So Suryavansham has Amitabh Bachchan in double role. So a son and the father. So in both cases, father's wife and son's wife, both voices are Rekha's voice. She's dubbed for both the actresses. So it's actually there must be some association. But the book was not just about it. Like I kept even repeating, the book is not just, this is awkward. Like Parth was, like, you know, Parth was the editor of the book. And we actually had a conversation that Parth, everyone will say we are writing gossip. So can we just remove this part, this Amitabh Bachchan episode of our life? But then we realized that that would not be Rekha's complete story. He's such an important part, by default, such an important part of her story that because she considers it a very sacred association and she has talked about it a lot and she completely credits him for her transformation, her physical transformation, her the way she looked at her career, acting, fitness, discipline. She completely credits Amitabh Bachchan for that. So it was very difficult and unfair to remove Amitabh Bachchan from her story. So it is a very important episode of her life. So we must talk about it, but it, her story is much more than that. And there's a very important interview of Muzaffar Ali in my book that I directed. He actually said, because I'm quoting Muzaffar Ali, he said ke wo aakar baithe rehte the shoot pe. Referring to Mr. Bachchan. And Rekha to aise kehti thi, wo aaye hain unse. Like you refer to your husband.
Yeah.
And I'm quoting Muzaffar Ali and he said ke Amitabh Bachchan should have married Rekha. I don't know. That's why, because Rekha, it's very difficult to reach Rekha. Like even for the book I tried. You know, she still uses that old phone with an answering machine. So it says that we should record your message after the beep. So I recorded so many messages on that answering machine and I could never reach her. But I was interviewing Gulzar Saab for the book because he has made Ijazat and he has made Khubsurat and Ghar, such brilliant films. So I was asking him about Rekha, and very nice interview about Rekha. And finally, after the interview was over, he asked me, "Ke aapne unse baat ki hai?" So maine kaha, "Nahi sir, it's very difficult. Matlab aap logon se hi, who are like approachable, unse hi milna itna mushkil hai. So how?" It's very difficult because she was not responding to my messages and my recorded messages. So she called up, he called up, Gulzar Saab called up Rekha and told her that this is someone who's writing about you and you should, and he's written a very good book on Rajesh Khanna and you should consider meeting him. So then again, sab kuch bhul gaya, but I think almost a month later, or 20 days later, I got a call from Rekha's house. And I had a long chat with her. But they were like, they were not sure, because after that 1919 incident, they were very, I think it's okay. They were, she wasn't ready to.
Yeah.
You know, because whatever had happened, she couldn't trust me. She doesn't know me.
Yeah.
Never. I just met her once during an award function as a journalist, and what a stunning, you know, actress she is. But I have never got a chance to interview her actually. So it was very difficult to get her voice in the book. Like I said, her old interviews from the archives, some rare interviews.
Yeah.
So that's how it happened. Sanjay Dutt I interviewed actually. I interviewed thrice. But he got upset with the biography. I think that's a story very close to my heart also because of Sunil Dutt. You know, it was a personal, very personal thing. I've interviewed Sunil Dutt Saab also and Sanjay Dutt also. And I have covered Sanjay Dutt case also as a journalist. I've made shows on him. But I think he got upset because he said, "Kini, I was too much about my personal life." But everything, he never asked me to stop the book or anything. He just said, "Kini, it's too much about," and he never took my permission because I don't know that I understand this permission business. Because I think if you're writing the truth and something which is already in the public domain, you don't need anyone's permission because that's not how you write history. And I consider this as film history or cinema history. So, like Rajesh Khanna had already passed away when I began writing. So, but their lives are so extensively covered. These are superstars. These are icons, and they've been stars for so many decades. So their lives, each important event of their lives, are so extensively covered. So what else they can, you know? I'm sure if Rekha will write her story someday, you will get some more stories, some personal stories. But overall, the basic arc of her stories, I think, would be similar to what's there in the book.
In the book,
because it is her own interviews through which we move forward in that book.
Yeah.
It could be both. It depends on the writer. Like in my case, my voice is completely missing from all my books, except the introduction part where I talk about why I decided to write on the subject. My voice, I never say I went there and I met her or she told me or he told me. That kind of voice or my own opinion. I have, you know, I make sure that this is not an open thing going on. So it has, my version is, okay, if taking an example of Silsila, you know? So if you're writing about the story of these three people, two Bachchans and a Rekha, I have to have these three versions first, like what Amitabh Bachchan was thinking or said in the press. Or if I get an interview, I ask a question about it. Rekha's version on Silsila, Jaya Bachchan's version on that film. And who were the other people, you know, associated with the film? So Yash Chopra is there, Silsila's writer is there, other co-stars is there. So that's how I complete the story. But their versions are very important, most of the versions. So if Amitabh Bachchan's version on, because there are many, Rekha is talking openly about Mr. Bachchan in many of his late 70s, 1970s interviews. But Amitabh Bachchan is not responding to those interviews. Rekha is talking very openly about their association, going to an extent, you know, where she's saying that he gave me these three rings which I am wearing, you know. But Amitabh Bachchan never responded to that interview. So I'm writing that Amitabh, Rekha said this in, you know, April or June 1979, yeah. And Amitabh Bachchan never responded to you, or if he responded, he said, you know, she's no more than my co-star. So those versions are very important.
Yeah.
So that's one very important thing. I normally, because Rekha as a figure, and due to her events in her life and her life story, seems very scandalous. So, so a normal thing that was covered in the media was that this is all about gossip. But if you go through the book, and because there's, it's a 200, more than 200 page book, not even one sentence in that book is according to sources.
Yeah.
You know, I don't work like that.
Yeah.
Or I wouldn't quote any gossip. So everything that is there has been in the print, and it has been either Rekha's statement or a statement of people who have closely worked with in firms or are close to her in the personal life. So that is my point, that you have to constantly avoid gossip. But if there is a question, which is a gossipy question, for example, if you talk about their relationship, their association, Amitabh Bachchan and Rekha, you have to talk about it, and you have to take as many versions as possible. And something which, when I say version, I'm talking about statements and interviews, so that there is no legal problem. So I can say in all my three books, I have not used this sentence called according to sources, or someone said, or people say. No, it is that's not how you write nonfiction.
Yeah.
You write Rekha said in April 1972.
Yeah.
Amitabh Bachchan said in August 1989.
Yeah.
So that's how you quote them. That quote is very important. If you are not talking to your subjects, and if you're talking to your subjects, then of course you're going to use those interviews.
Yeah.
Rekha's book was went through a legal check, like you know. Book. In fact, biographies always go through legal checks. So it was there for almost 20 days, and when it came back, it was completely red.
Yeah.
Everything was underlined, and then the editor Parth also said, yeah, there's so much underlined. I said, don't worry, because I'm like sure about it. We can actually write this if this is in public domain, and this interview is an official interview. You can of course quote them and write about it. So the research process is a difficult process, because everyone says ki acha isme what's untold in this story. So I always say the untold here lies in not revealing the lesser known details. It is basically about seeing all of it together, because seeing one thing in isolation, like talk only about her association with Mr. Bachchan, is not the complete story.
Right.
Nor her association or her tragedy with Mukesh Agarwal is her complete story. So when you talk about most of the important events in her life, you get a complete personality.
Yeah.
That's how, that is my process. That's how I go about it.
Yeah.
And I think that's why it connects with people, because it is also an effort to humanize the enigma. That's true. That's actually true. Yeah. And again, because of her proximity to Mr. Bachchan, she was referred to as the Lady Amitabh Bachchan, because she was actually playing roles, which action roles, like I said, Phool Bane Angare or Khoon Bhari Maang, they were all revenge stories.
Yeah.
She was wronged in the first half of the film, and then she came back to take the revenge. And so I think that was the thing. And of course, now you talk about Shilpa Shetty or a Katrina Kaif doing yoga videos. Rekha began that trend. So there was actually a VHS cassette where she is the yoga icon.
Yeah.
Doing all those yoga poses. So she was the first one to do that. She used to do her own makeup. She learned to do, she did something. She went to London and learned the entire makeup technique. So a lot of, there were a lot of write-ups about how Rekha has transformed, her face, her complexion, the way. Because and in those days the gossip was ki uske makeup men se poochho, but makeup men used to say ki nahi wo to khud hi karti hai. So all these things were actually covered in the media, and it was fun to read them. Those magazines were actually fun, but Rekha Kain was actually a trendsetter in terms of makeup, fitness. If you look at Rekha of 1969, Savan Bhadu, and Rekha of Khubsurat or Umrao Jan, I mean, they're two different people. But what I know is that she's at peace with herself, and she's, you know, जैसा कि होता है ना कि मैं लोगों से तंग आ चुकी हूँ, मतलब people are not worth it. That's the reality of life. People are really not worth it. So she's happy with herself. She lives with Farzana in that bungalow, and she doesn't come out for many parties or, you know, events. It's basically, her relevance is basically every Filmfare award or Aziz Cine award, where she comes to give the best award, the award for the best actor or the best actress. And as soon as she is on the stage, the camera cuts to